Welcome to Spotlight on Migraine, hosted by the Association of Migraine Disorders. Join us for fresh perspectives by medical experts and advocates as we explore the spectrum of migraine and dig deeper into this complex disease. This episode is brought to you by our generous sponsor, Lundbeck.
I'll be speaking on non-invasive vagus nerve stimulation in the treatment of acute vestibular migraine attacks. The Latin meaning of the vagus is wandering, and it relates to the long course of the vagus nerve throughout the body. It begins in the brainstem, the largest of the cranial nerves, and extends throughout the entire body, innervating the respiratory system, the cardiovascular system, and the gastrointestinal system, among others. The efferent fibers of the vagus nerve come predominantly from two nuclei in the brainstem, which are the nucleus ambiguous and the dorsal motor nucleus of the vagus nerves. The afferent fibers terminate in three major areas, one being the nucleus tractus solitarius. This is the main relay station for all afferent vagus projections, the spinal nucleus of the trigeminal nerve, and area postrema. There are several fiber types in the vagus nerve. The A fibers are the large myelinated fibers in general. The B is the small myelinated fibers, and C are unmyelinated fibers. Most of the fibers in the vagus nerve, about 60 to 80%, consist of C-type fibers. Vagus nerve stimulation has a long history in neurology, going back to the 19th century, when J.L. Corning found that vagus nerve stimulation could stop epileptic seizures. At that time, however, the reasoning for it was that epilepsy arose from excess blood supply to the brain. And so his device was designed to compress the carotid arteries to reduce blood supply to the brain and stimulate the vagus nerves on both sides with the goal of reducing cardiac output and cutting down the blood supply to the brain. Now, although the reasoning was wrong, the stimulation of the vagus nerve did help with the epileptic seizures. And so VNS, although it was found in the 19th century, it kind of fell out of favor until the late 80s, when experiments and animal models showed that indeed vagus nerve stimulation could stop epileptic seizures. And so in the 90s, the VNS devices were approved for the treatment of refractory epilepsy, which are, seizures that are not responsive to medications. Typically, there was a surgical implantation of a stimulator device with leads that are, in the upper chest, and leads wrapping around the left cervical vagus nerve. The devices administer a regular stimulation to the vagus nerve to reduce the number of seizures. And when a patient finds that, feels that a seizure is coming on, it can wave a magnetic wand over the device and stimulate the vagus nerve again to terminate a seizure. It is fairly effective. About 20 to 40% of people with a VNS device find that their seizure frequencies reduced by more than 50%. Now, VNS use in migraine treatments was, like a lot of discoveries in science and medicine, serendipitous. So there was, in 2002, there was a case report of an adult patient who had a VNS device placed for refractory epilepsy. And although it did not help with his seizures, they found, interestingly, that it reduced the number of migraine attacks and was able to abort migraine attacks in this patient. And so eventually this led to the development of the gammaCore device. So the gammaCore device is a non-invasive vagus nerve stimulator that is placed on the neck. And, as you will expect, surgical implantation of a vagus nerve stimulating device, could be accompanied by multiple complications. And therefore, a non-invasive device would be ideal. It's easy to carry around. It's very safe to administer. The device stimulates predominantly the A and B type of fibers and spares the C fibers, and therefore, causes much less pain and carries, far less risk of heart issues, particularly arrhythmias. I know this is a very busy slide, but it basically summarizes all the studies that have been done in the treatment of headaches so far utilizing this, the gamma core device. And as you can see, you know, for migraine headaches and for cluster headaches, there are multiple studies that show that the gamma core device actually really helps with these disorders. Nothing was done for vestibular migraine until very recently. What I did was, you know, I found I had a group of patients who had vestibular migraine, established patients, a well-known history of vestibular migraine, which I follow on a regular basis, with a mean, these were about 18 patients, mean age of about 45 years. 14 of these patients, you know, when they came to see me in the clinic, were in the midst of an acute vestibular migraine attack, and four of them, had, you know, really bothersome, you know, interictal dizziness. And we'll talk about these two separate groups in a bit. In the first group, those that came with an acute vestibular migraine attack, these were 14 patients, mostly women. They had not taken any medications, no rescue medications, no benzodiazepines, and no antiemetics. And in most of them had woken up that morning within the midst of a vestibular migraine attack, and they had been seen in clinic that same day. So these group were seen within about 6 hours of the vestibular migraine attack starting. Two patients, you know, these, they, while they were sitting in the waiting room, they suffered a vestibular migraine attack, and we could treat them within 15 minutes of the onset. Before we treated them with the gamma core device, they were asked to grade their vertigo and headache on the using the visual analog scale. A scale of 1 to 10, you know, 1 being the mildest pain and 10 being the worst ever pain or vertigo severity. We then administered a two-minute bilateral neck stimulation, starting first on the right and then on the left with the gamma core device, in line with the PRESTO study performed by Dr. Tassarelli's group. 15 minutes after treatment with the gamma core, we asked them to grade the severity of their vertigo and headache, again using the same visual analog scale. And so we found that in 13 of 14 patients, there was improvement in the severity of the vertigo. Two patients experienced complete resolution, and five patients reported an at least 50% reduction in the severity of their vertigo. So in this table shows that, you know, before treatment, the mean severity was about 5.2, and after treatment is about 3.1. meaning about a, you know, 40-something percent change on of a reduction in the severity of the vertigo. All five patients who experienced headache with their attacks of vestibular migraine reported improvement in the headache severity. Now, we treated about four patients for, you know, very bothersome interictal type of dizziness. So these were patients with triple PD, or persistent postural perceptual dizziness. They were not in the midst of a vestibular migraine attack. However, they did mention that their triple PD dizziness was just, you know, much more bothersome that particular day when they were seen in clinic. And so we offered them a treatment with the gamma core device. But these, all four of them reported no change whatsoever in the severity of their dizziness after treatment. That was very, very well tolerated. Only one patient, you know, described some neck discomfort, muscle tightness in the neck, but all the others found that the treatment, you know, was very well tolerated. In another group of patients that we I saw, these were four patients, you know, established patients again with vestibular migraine attacks, with vestibular migraine, who were seen in the midst of an acute attack. These were established patients, you know, when I had well-documented, you know, interictal examination findings. So, you know, these were patients I had examined a few times during the attack-free period, and I was familiar with what their exam findings were. None of them had taken any rescue medications, benzodiazepines, or antiemetics. Before treatment, you know, we had them grade the severity of their vertigo and headache, again using the same visual analog scale, 1 being the mildest, you know, vertigo headache, 10 being the most severe vertigo headache ever. And also they had a bedside neurologic examination performed with video goggles. 15 minutes after treatment, with the gamma core device, and they were treated the same way as in the previous one, with one 2-minute stimulation on the right side of the neck and a second one on the left side of the neck. After 15 minutes after treatment, we had them grade the vertigo and headache again, and we also performed the same examination. So in this patient population, we found that, you know, very similar to the first one, the severity of vertigo did get better, and the severity of the headache as well. So in all four patients, they had a reduction in the severity of the vertigo. Two of the patients report complete resolution of vertigo and complete resolution of headache. Now, the interesting part was, you know, this case series of patients, all of them had abnormal findings during the attack of vestibular migraine. So in patient one, there was spontaneous right beating to start with removal of fixation. Patient two had spontaneous upbeat nystagmus with removal of fixation, and patient three had positional right beating nystagmus in the Dixal pipe positions. You know, so during these were the findings during the vestibular migraine attack. After the vestibular migraine attack, which means after they had been treated with the gamma core device, there was no nystagmus whatsoever. This was the video recording of patient one. And during the attack, as you can see, this patient has right beating nystagmus with removal of fixation. After treatment, upon cessation of the vestibular migraine attack, as you can see, the nystagmus has completely resolved, and he's back to his usual interictal examination findings. One more time. As you can see, there's right beating nystagmus there. And after treatment, the nystagmus is completely resolved. Now, patient four was a far more interesting patient. This was a patient who had a history of right vestibular neuritis to about 2 years prior to the onset of any vestibular migraine symptoms. And so at baseline, on examination, he has left beating nystagmus. Let's watch what happens during a vestibular migraine attack and after treatment with the gamma core device. So during the attack, you see there's extremely mild left beating nystagmus. After treatment, upon cessation of his vestibular migraine attack, you notice that the left beating nystagmus has become much more brisk. And so in this patient, the interesting finding here is that his vestibular migraine attack actually resulted in a reduction of the nystagmus that he usually has during the intellectual period. So the possible hypothesis here is that the changes brought about by vestibular migraine actually opposed the left beating nystagmus that he usually has on interictal examination. And so when the vestibular migraine attack stopped, his usual left beating nystagmus came right back. As you can see one more time, during the migraine attack, we see very little left beating nystagmus. But after the attack, nystagmus comes right back. So, you know, the main question is, how does non-invasive vagus nerve stimulation abort acute vestibular migraine attacks? You know, what could be the possible explanation for this? And so I think the answer boils down to, you know, the connections, right? The networks that exist in our brainstem. There are intimate connections between the vestibular system and the vagus system. And, you know, you can tell this from, you know, a lot of the manifestations that we see in patients. So, you know, anything that causes a patient to suffer vertigo is accompanied by nausea, vomiting, and a variety of vegetative autonomic type of symptoms. The person becomes very pale, very sweaty, they feel really clammy. Orthostatic reflexes are also due to vestibular vagal network. So, you know, your vestibular system detects when you are upright, when you change position, and, you know, induces the appropriate changes in your blood pressure and in your pulse rate to accommodate for that. And these are accomplished through the vestibular vagal connections. The trigeminal, the vestibular, and vagus systems also are intimately connected. And I think it is the connections between the three systems that are responsible for the benefits that we see with non-invasive vagus nerve stimulation in vestibular migraine. So, you know, the evidence of the connections between the three systems can be seen in, you know, nausea that happens during the migraine, the motion sickness that, you know, a lot of migraine sufferers experience, and how vestibular stimulation often can trigger a migraine headache. There are numerous brainstem locations where the trigeminal, the vagus, and the vestibular systems meet and talk to each other. The biggest one is, of course, the nucleus tractus solitarius. This is a huge meeting place for all three systems. The dorsal motor nucleus of the vagus nerve is another location where, you know, all three systems tend to connect. And other locations include the rostroventral lateral medulla, the reticular formation, and the locus ceruleus, as well as the nucleus intercalatus in the lower part of the medulla. Other potential ways that, you know, the vagus nerve stimulation suppresses vestibular migraine may be because of, you know, modulation of GABA, dopamine, and norepinephrine levels. Now, as you know, migraine is associated with, you know, deficiencies or problems with the GABA levels, with dopamine levels, with the norepinephrine levels. And so the vagus nerve stimulation may, you know, influence migraine attacks by modulating the levels of these neurotransmitters. Another way that, you know, VNS can suppress inflammation is by inhibiting the release of pro-inflammatory cytokines and results in a reduction in migraine. And as we know, neurogenic inflammation is one of the critical components of a migraine attack. And so the VNS may act on migraines and may terminate migraines by suppressing this inflammatory response. Thank you very much.
Thank you for tuning into Spotlight on Migraine. For more information on migraine disease, please visit migrainedisorders.org.